Welcome to 1202, the Human Factors Podcast, the podcast that covers all things about humans,
technology,
and particularly the bit in between.
And welcome to this episode of 1202, the Human Factors Podcast. It has been a while, and I know that we haven't been keeping up with as many episodes as I normally like to do, but work, everything, this is the way it is at the moment. So, but because we've been doing this, we wanted to bring you something a bit new and a little bit different. So today we're going to be learning about the Human Factors community in Australia. Before we get into that, a quick message for all you members of the Chartered Institute of Ergonomics and Human Factors, so the CIHF here in the UK. You should have had an email from me inviting you to take part in a member survey. Please, if you have the time, or if you don't have the time, please make the time to do it. It takes about 15 minutes, and it's about you. It's about your organisation, the CIHF. And if you give us your input, then that means we can help form the future strategy and make the organisation work for you. Now, I'm sure if you're listening to this, you'll have done this already, and that's absolutely fantastic. I have another ask for you, and that is you've all got your networks, be that on LinkedIn, be that on Facebook, Twitter, or X, as we cool kids have to call it now. Please share it on there. If nothing else, next time you're talking to your colleagues, your peers, please tell them about it and make sure that they filled it in too. The more input we get, then the better we make our organisation. So, lecture over. You know what to do. Go and fill it out, please. Back to today's episode. One of the cool things about being president of the CIHF is the opportunity to talk to people around the world about the current state of human factors and seeing how it evolves and works in different countries, because different countries have different priorities, they have different needs, and they have different levels of engagement. And also then we get to talk to them about potential opportunities for collaboration and cooperation. So today's guest is the current president of the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society of Australia, Sharon Todd. And I thought it'd be really fantastic to invite her on here to help share her perspective of the human factors from literally the other side of the world. So without further ado, Sharon, welcome and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for asking me, Barry. It's great to be here.
Now, I feel like I'm going to be under some sort of exam because I know that you do your own podcast out there in Australia as well. So this is another one of these episodes where podcasts collide. So any mistakes that I make, please just do overlook them and don't point them out to everybody else. But before we get into the setup in Australia, can you tell us a bit more about you, your current role and what you do on a day-to-day basis?
Okay, so I'm currently, apart from being the president of the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society of Australia, I'm a certified professional ergonomist and I work as a consultant. And in that role, I do mostly short-term project work at the sharp end, and I also do opinion work at the other end when things have gone horribly wrong.
So that gives you a real breadth of all the experiences across basically all elements of the human factors. That's going to be quite fascinating. But how did you get onto this train? How did you get into human factors in the first place?
I always think this is a great question, and it is the question that I ask everybody that I talk to on my podcast as well. And I'm fascinated at the answers. I always think that my journey is not nearly as exciting as somebody else's, but let's see how we go. So as you would know, human factors and ergonomics professionals come from a range of backgrounds, and I'm from background. So I started my career when I left school. I was going to be a registered nurse. In fact, I am a registered nurse. I was going to be a midwife. And apart from having babies, I've been nowhere near babies ever since. But number of years, obviously, training to be a registered general nurse. And whilst I enjoyed that and thought that was my career, part of the way through my training, we had an occupational health module that came in. And that's really interesting. And I found in my career that whenever my brain thinks that, it is somewhere where I end up going. It's just something that's happened. So anyway, this module, I thought it was interesting. Life goes on. I was applying for some new positions at a hospital, and it was at a time where it was quite hard to get nursing positions, believe it or not, back then. I won't tell you when, but back then it was quite hard. And a position in occupational health came up, and it was working for a factory, and I was going to be the occupational health nurse. And I thought, okay, this looks great. Why don't I apply for that? So I applied for it and I got it. And at the start, I thought, oh, this is great. It's all about nursing. But what I discovered was that my interest was much greater in terms of, instead of pulling a bloke out of a machine, you know, fixing him up, it was a whole idea to actually being caught in the machine to start with. So it started to roll into this, morphed into this safety role. And then I obviously moved around as an occupational health nurse for a while, working in different industries. The great thing about that was, I mean, I started in sheet metal. I've been in construction, I've been in manufacturing, I've been in food. That happens to be one of my favorite, by the way. And I just love machinery and I love watching how things are made. And from that was an interest in industry. And because of the work that I was doing and the safety role that this had morphed into, I was trying to rectify problems that were happening in manufacturing. So someone on a particular line, we were trying to work out ways to stop that. And so there's a crude form of human factors and ergonomics. And so I was in that industry for quite some time. I then, because I had a family and three small children, I started working in injury management, which in Australia, and I'm sure overseas as well, is obviously about returning people to work after injury. The great thing about that as well is that this then exposed me to far more industries and different workplaces and this great fascination for where work part of my life. And I decided that the way through that, that clearly I had a huge interest in ergonomics. And so I decided to do something about it. And I went back and did a master's in ergonomics here in Australia. And then I continued working in injury management for quite some time because I could use all those skills and I could then do all these worksite assessments for all sorts of people as a consultant. And then I decided that after quite a number of years, I would go in. And I did some generalist safety roles, by the way, in here. I also did some generalist ergonomics roles in health. I obviously being a health lounge, going back into health as an ergonomist, I'm quite good. I was doing patient handling work at that point. And these days, as I said, I do consulting and I work predominantly doing short-term project work, which can be anything from design of a system, but alongside a number of other people, clearly, or it might be just fixing a problem that's arisen because someone's been injured and we're working out what we're going to do about that. And then the expert opinion work, bringing into play everything that I've ever learned, both in health as well as in industry, and giving an opinion on where liability lies.
So the whole expert opinion piece, if you don't mind me delving into that a little bit, that's a really interesting element, isn't it? Because it's, you're not only bringing all your skills into play, but you're kind of putting yourself on the line as well, because you've got to, you're going in there and saying, look, I know what I'm talking about. And they, the opposition, will grill you to make sure that you are an expert. Could you give us a bit of insight into how that works and how that feels?
I've been doing this now for about 13 years. So I will tell you that how it feels now versus how it felt when I started, probably a little bit different. However, it's a very challenging area to be in because it relies on you pulling together everything that you know and making sure that you only give an opinion on something that you know a whole lot about. So clearly the first step is only writing an opinion in the area where you experience and you work. And that is the most important aspect of that role. And that would absolutely be challenged. And it's extremely important that you stay within your field of expertise. So that means that you have to understand where you fit and what opinions you can give. And then you have to also understand what is outside your field of expertise. And when I first started, I won't say it's a little bit grey, but sometimes you have an understanding of something, or there's psychosocial risk factors in the workplace, and you just don't want them to think that you're giving a psychologist opinion when what you're really doing is addressing a system of work opinion. Right. So for me, what it was about was making sure that, number one, I was within my field of expertise. Number two, making sure that I stay within it. Number three, making sure that that I know what my opinion is, because your opinion needs to be solid, and your opinion is the same opinion whether you're writing a plaintiff report or a defendant report. So right. No matter which side of the fence you are, which side of the scene is correct in the report, your opinion needs to be the same, because it's not about changing your opinion for the person that's requesting the report. It's about being very solid about where liability lies, very solid about what is reasonable and what is not, being solid in terms of what controls could be used, and in your experience you would be challenged about your experience on implementation of those controls possibly, and whether those controls are industry practice. So it's a really interesting field to be in, and I write predominantly, I obviously do healthcare in terms of nursing and patient handling, because I have experience in that and recent experience in that as well. And I write manufacturing in terms of manual handling in manufacturing and problems associated with that. And also I did slip, strips and falls as part of my master's degree, and so I comment on slip, strips and falls as well.
So when you did that for the first time, when you first stepped into the courtroom to basically defend your opinion in that, what was that like?
I think terrifying is probably the right word. look, it was terrifying, but actually the very first court appearance, to be honest, I was very inexperienced, but all I knew was how to tell the truth. Yeah. And that was actually a really good thing, because even though you think you have to sound unbelievably intelligent, which on some days we might do and on other days we definitely don't, it was brilliant, because when they asked and you just gave them the honest answer, which is this, look, in this particular situation, and I don't know if I can try and think of the first case I was in court for, was a person that was hit trolley. So they're working in a factory and someone knocks them over with a trolley. And so there was a discussion about how this could have happened. And so the trolley and whether you can see through the trolley and all those human factors aspects are in that discussion. But I just found that by knowing this is what I know to be true, this is what my facts and assumptions are, you're given facts and assumptions to work with. So this is what I'm working on, and in this area, this is my opinion. And I just stayed within it and stayed true to what I understood is the matter at hand. And for the moment, I actually can't remember what the controls were in this particular matter, but anyway, bottom line is it was terrifying, but it was a good experience. And then from there, I realized that training was a really good idea. And so I actually did the course that's in the UK. So Bond Salon runs a course, and I did it from Australia via Skype. And I found that course was really, really good. And some of the aspects of the course, obviously, that courtroom procedures and very, very important. And I really liked the most, in fact, about that, the 3-hour cross-examination with the barrister, where you were allowed to make the mistakes. And so they would say, don't go there. And you'd be going, oops, I think I've gone there. Okay. And it helped you formulate ways to answer the question, because you know the stuff. It's just working out how do you answer the questions, and you're terrified, so therefore your cognition is a bit down sometimes and questions need to be reworded. Well, you can ask. And if you don't understand the question, you don't answer it. And if you need more information about whatever it is you're being asked, then you ask for it. And once you knew that, then consolidate that with everything else, which is your knowledge and understanding of the topic, it isn't as bad. However, it can be quite stressful depending on what's really being asked at the time.
I think that's the point about training and the way that you're feeling is a really strong message for quite a lot of people, because I've been a magistrate here in the UK, so I've been at the top of the bench wanting to get the information out of witnesses of all different types. And it's, I've had that commentary back to me that it all looks very formal and very engaging. Whereas actually, I remember the first time I sat up there myself and I was terrified. Am I going to ask the right questions in the right way to get the right answers? And so we sort of have this idea that the courtroom is a very formal, formal place. Everybody knows what they're doing and everybody does know what they're doing, but it doesn't mean to say that you're not nervous about what you're doing and trying to work out the best way of delivering that information. So I feel we could go on for a long time about this because I find the way that we engage with the legal system quite fascinating. So, but how has it changed? You sort of mentioned how you were right at the beginning. How has that changed now? If you go into the courtroom now, I'm guessing there's still an element of nervousness, but how do you feel that change has evolved?
I think it's just experience. The better you, it's practice. You become better at something the more you do it. And I think when you've of an experience that may not have been a great one or one where you felt that you didn't perform well or you didn't give, and I use the word perform meaning you didn't give the answers that you would have given if you'd known about things a day ahead. Do you know what I mean? So that the, so it feels like a bit of a performance because you have to remember what's been asked, interpret it and answer, but also try and work out where they're going. Because it's important to work out where they are going with their questioning, and it's not always where you think they're going. Hmm. So the more experience I have, the I am able, but not in every situation, but the better I'm usually able to work out where I think they're going, because you have an elevator pitch, and the elevator pitch is the thing that you think is the crux of the matter, the thing that needs to be said. And I always go into court thinking where I look for the weakness in my report and I look for the weakness in the matter. I expect them to question me there. They're never going to question me about something that's solid. They are going to target me for something that they think is, you know, a little bit of leeway in there for discussion. So I try to work, think that might be, and sometimes I'm way off and there are something entirely different. Prepare my elevator pitch, which is if I get asked this question, what will I be saying? How they ask them, because eventually it hopefully get there. I'm better at framing the answer. I'm better at being very solid at my opinion or in their question, but still putting the tail in, which is my elevator pitch. So I think it, for argument's sake, I do remember on that very first matter that I dealt with in court, they had asked a number of questions and there was a hypothetical situation that they asked me to consider, which I did. And at the end of it, I answered their question, but I then said, but housekeeping, which is what you're referring to, is not relevant to this matter. Mm. So the experience just makes you more confident to be able to answer the question, but also opinion more widely.
That we could go on about for hours about this because it is truly fascinating. And the last question before we get into the HFESA as a whole is you mentioned about setting up, you know, as a consultant to do this all of the work that you do. What was that stepping stone for you saying right? I want to go it alone. Effectively, I want to start my own. What was that conversation like for yourself and how did it work?
Well, this was a really good conversation, to be honest. And I think this question's a great question because for anybody who's an early career person or anyone making a change in their career and about to move out and do this, the key is networking. Now, I have always been someone to network. In fact, my husband has always said to me, not another lunch, Sharon. How much lunch do you possibly need? But I say it's not good. Company. I've always, in my career, I've always kept up with a core group of people, and in this, obviously, a lot of them are now members of the Human Factors and Ergonomic Society of Australia. However, there are a lot of consultants, however, that was working with in various fields. These physios, they often have ergonomics as part of their toolkit, but they may not have been a member of the society at the time. But we would have all these lunches and talk about our work. And then you find out what's actually happening in industry, and you find out what people are doing, and you problem solve across these lunches. And people know what you're interested in. Anyway, stemming from that is clearly society, the Human Factors and Ergonomic Society, had a number of conferences, and they had what was called a Ergo Big Day Out. And this was a careers day where you could go and people were talking about what they were doing. And so I came with the view to think about moving out as a consultant. But I did it gradually, by the way. I had a part-time job and I picked up a couple of part-time non-ongoing projects. They were my bread and butter, so that helped pay the mortgage. And then it was the other days I could choose the work that I did. And so the careers day that we had was a fabulous day because we had someone talking about expert opinions. Was the thing where I went, aha, that's the thing I'm interested in. And after years, and by the way, this was years and years and years of experience in industry, full stop. And I spoke to someone in the room afterwards and said, I know nothing about this, but I'm really interested in expert opinion work. And do you think somebody would mentor me, or is there some way that someone could help me? And so this person said, look, we'll see what we can do. And so X amount of time later, and that was probably about 6 to 8 weeks, I had a call, and they said that they knew a consultant who was interested in mentoring someone that needed help along the way, and my background and skills would work with the type of reports that they were writing. And so that's where it started. And so I was mentored by a man by the name of David Dubow, who I still do some report writing for. And it was a fabulous opportunity to learn and have someone who is that mentor where you can bounce off about, is this, am I on the right track? And that also the person who can then say to you, look, you've missed the boat, you've gone here, but you could also go here. And so whilst your opinion, and he's not writing the report with you, was able to oversee some of the things I was writing to start with. So the expert opinion work was the mentoring aspect. The other consulting end, which is the project work, it just grew out of people who I knew and networking. And so my colleagues who had projects would ring and say, do you want to work on this project with me? And I'd say, yes. And so I'd work on this project. And so I've always been someone who said almost yes to every project, even though sometimes I stepped into a project and I've known very little about it, because you learn, and you learn so much more than you ever thought you were going to learn. And you come out of the end of it going, wow, I'm so glad I did that. And then those skills are the skills that you use for another project. And my career is a series of stepping stones where I've always learned something on a project and used it on the next project. And then you learn something on project and then new project, and so the two things are networking experience and saying yes when a project comes up, and being bold enough to say, sure, I know nothing about it, but I'll do it with you.
I think they're two absolutely golden pieces of advice. What we're going to do is going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come back and talk about the Ergonomic Society in a bit more detail. So we'll be right back after this.
Okay.
You are listening to 1202, the Human Factors Podcast. We wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you for your support. You can help further by rating us through your podcast provider, sharing us through social media, and telling your friends and colleagues. Let's work together in raising awareness of the value in putting users at the center of what we do.
And welcome back. Today we're talking with Sharon Todd, the current president of the HFESA, or the Human Factors and Ergonomic Society of Australia. So, Sharon, if we can now focus a bit more on the organisation itself, and it may sound like a silly question in a way, but can you give us a bit of background into the society and sort of how it came about and what your aims are on a day-to-day basis?
Okay, so the society in Australia started in 1966, so a little bit before I was, a very large girl. And so that, and it was a group of ergonomists that started the society. So professional, a few members, of course. And I think around 1987, New Zealand formed its own society, and then ultimately the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society of Australia then changed its name and became the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society of Australia. And aim of the society at the time was to advance science application and promotion education and human factors and ergonomics in Australia, and to improve safety, efficiency and usability of systems through products, environment and well-being of users. So it was a society created by human factors and ergonomics professionals for the purposes of and advancement of HFE.
Cool. I mean, again, like I said, it almost sounds like an obvious thing to say, because I guess most societies around the world form for similar reasons. It's like-minded people coming together. What sort of things do you get up to? I mean, obviously, we have like our conference and things like that here in the UK. I should imagine you have similar, because you've got your conference coming up in November. With that conference in November, what sort of topics are you bringing in? And in general, what other things do you get up to?
Okay, so let's do the what do we get up to first question, probably. So obviously our flagship event is the conference every year, and I'll come back to that. But we run professional development modules and seminars for members. We are clearly running some podcasts, and those podcasts are to further advancement of the understanding of HFE in a wider community, but also to serve as some professional development for our members, because if we're talking about a wide range of topics, a lot of us work in a narrow area. There's lots of things we don't work in, so it's great to talk to people about all sorts, and it's a learning curve then for all of us. And we have special interest groups, and those special interest groups are looking at specific areas of interest such as slips, trips and falls, or human factors in health, or human factors in transport or design. And we've previously had some in Australia, occupational health and safety special interest group as well. And we're talking about, and it's in its infancy, we're actually talking about putting together a special interest group for sedentary workers, because there's a lot of people who do sedentary work. And over the years, that's where people think ergonomics is, that's all we do. And so we've steered well away from that. But in actual fact, there's a whole lot of factors. I mean, you know, if you're a pilot or a train driver, you're seated for prolonged periods. So you're seated in comfort and various aspects of what happens when you're sedentary and unable to move is really important. So it's vigilance and all those things that come into it. So we're tossing, I'm adding an extra group there. They're the main two things that we do with the special interest group, the professional development events, the podcast, or there's three things. The conference, of course, is coming up in November, and that's where the big networking happens. So this is where we bring international speakers and obviously great speakers from Australia together, and we talk about doing, and it's quite diverse. So this year you've got everything from health, manufacturing, aviation, and defence. And we've just put up the draft program, and I can't sort of recite that off by heart at this point in time. If you're interested, have a look at hfesa.org.au, and on the front page just click through from the conference and the draft program is up and running. And this year we've got Chris Reed from Boeing coming to chat, which is fabulous. And we have Patrick Newman coming from Canada, and he's chatting about all sorts of things because he works in some very interesting areas in health and manufacturing. He's talking about manufacturing, and Gillian Dorian from South Australia. So they're the main things that we do, and that we're interested, though, in looking at connecting more with the early career groups and students. And we're also looking at the moment, we're steering towards looking at the problem we have with education in human factors and ergonomics. We're looking at where those gaps are and trying to work out how we can improve education for human factors and ergonomics professionals. And also looking at trying to put education into undergraduate courses so that we are introducing human factors very early, because what's traditionally happened, really, we don't have an undergraduate course. So what's traditionally happened is that people have their careers, a bit like yourself and my career, and then you find human factors and ergonomics along the way. we think it would be really great, given that humans are in everything, if we had some understanding, obviously, a little bit earlier in the piece. So there's a lot of work to be done there that hasn't necessarily been done yet, but we're looking at that at the moment.
I think that's really interesting because we've got the same problem here in the UK where we've had undergraduate courses and then they've sort of petered out because I think there's a number of reasons, but fundamentally people grew up wanting to be astronauts, firefighters, nurses, doctors. Nobody grows up wanting to be an ergonomist when they're at sort of age 4, 5, 6, and 7. And so we sort of lose out, I think, on that. And then people find, as you've quite well described, people find human factors and ergonomics and go, oh, that's cool. And then talk to people like yourself about the, you know, cool careers they've had and the interesting bits, and then get all excited about it and then get into it and do the masters and move on. And so that is clearly a worldwide challenge. It's not just our own country's challenge, because it feels like it's becoming a familiar story. So clearly we've all got work to do there, and the more we can share on that, the better. Talking about human factors in Australia specifically, what are your, I guess, your biggest challenges, do you think, at the moment, the education piece aside?
Okay. So in actual fact, the biggest challenge which we've had, and I'm thinking we may be sort of on the way out of that, was that COVID obviously put us all home, and then we've had a huge problem getting people to want to leave home, which I think is probably fascinating, because I was, I think, the first person out the door. But when it's come to events, face-to-face events, as small events, not the conference. The conference is doing really well, and that's going to be a great conference. And the numbers at the moment are tracking really, really well. And we're 6 weeks out. And so if you want to come or you want to just join us on hybrid, please do an awesome event. But aside from that, some of the big issues for us are probably not understanding why people suddenly want to be at home more and don't think a trip to the pub to get together and chat about human factors and ergonomics is something that they're wanting to do as often. So we've had to morph into a more hybrid platform for our PD events. And so they are quite well received, and we are doing really well with our numbers. And clearly it gives us the opportunity to be more global in who attends. So really what we thought was a problem, which is people don't want to leave home, around and trying to make it a benefit, because Australia is an enormous country. I don't actually know where the UK just fits into New South Wales, but Australia is huge. It's hours and hours to fly from one end to the other. And consequently, that means national development events on the ground are difficult because people have to travel a long way. And I think Australians may have realised is that they've discovered work-life balance. And so when they come home from work, they don't want to go out again. They're going, no, I can do this from home. So assuming, given that I'm not the psychologist, assuming that part of what's happened, the bonus for this is that people who are in regional areas can now get professional development that they couldn't get before. So making our stuff available to them has been something that we've been working on more. And so we've run far more PD events this year than we've ever done. And we've run about 20, and we've been running them probably about 2 or 3 a month. And depending on the month and any events that are on, pardon me. And those events have been able to reach a much wider audience. So what we are discovering is that whilst we thought COVID was a bad thing, and it certainly wasn't a good thing for so many people in the world, it has allowed us to do something that we never did before. So we are now very happy to be virtual, very happy to be hybrid. This opportunity to chat with you in the UK is a huge opportunity that wasn't really there. One of the reasons why we started our podcast was also promotion out to people. So we know that project enabled us to reach far and wide and reach people who are outside the society, which we weren't really doing before either. So the future for us is about looking at getting human factors ergonomic society, getting the subject out into a wider community. And so this is what we're doing. I'm excited about the opportunity for us to be found as well. In fact, I always think this is great. When the regulator rings you and says, can you interview our head to talk about safety and human factors and a safety conference that's coming up in the beginning of at the end of the year, which is the World Congress in Safety that's here. I think that's exciting when they're ringing you and saying, hey, could you do this on your podcast for us? So this is working. And the other, one of the other things that we're trying to do is have people clearly understand who we are and what we do. I mean, if I have to answer the question one more time, what is an ergonomist? that'll be great because I've had 5,000 different versions of what is an ergonomist. And, you know, I think I've got it down to the slogan on the website that we've used, which is connecting human capability with good design. And it just keeps it short, but you've got to explain that it's about systems and various other things. It would be so much better if people knew what we did. But the future is, I think, is good here in Australia in terms of the opportunity. I'm hoping that we can have more human factors, not just in courses, but in more regulatory material. So whilst we have Australian standards and whilst there are human factors component in a lot of them, it's not in every subject. So what we're doing is producing position papers where we can then have that position paper considered as part of a standards committee review on a standard to try and get human factors into the discussion and try and have people understand what that looks like. For argument's sake, there is some review on slips and trips and falls standards here in Australia, and we're hoping to have more human factors and ergonomics approach in that standard as well, so people understand visual processing and top-down processing and bottom-up processing and expectancy bias and all the things and what that is and what it looks like and how it works. And we're seeing a little bit more human factors uptake in health, which is really important, obviously, given that my background is health, and we know that health is like a massive multitude of different industries all under one roof. I mean, I remember when I first started nursing, I thought, my goodness, this is an entirely different world. I think I've entered a parallel universe. And really that is almost, because it operates independently of everything else at times. And so it's area, and we know that the UK has huge input in human factors over there, and we're obviously being down under, as people put it, as a disadvantage in some ways, because we're a little bit behind in terms of the pickup on that. But we are getting more traction there. We're seeing more human factors opportunities come, and some of our professionals who have worked predominantly in rail or transports, aviation and rail. We're seeing those groups moving more into health. And so, things into alert fatigue and into design of spaces and digital twin image. I've lost it for a second because I don't work in that space. But in digital twins to work out what's happening in the space and how they can improve the system. So there's a lot of work that is gradually happening, and it's a great opportunity to be in human factors in Australia at this point in time, because there are huge opportunities. So if you've got an interest, you can absolutely find someone to work with on a project.
That sounds brilliant, and I'm almost wanting some sort of exchange program where I can come and work myself, because I think as you quite rightly say, there's been there seems to be a growth in Australia where there's a whole, but you have a whole bunch of different fields that we just don't get to see to work in, that we kind of take for granted, and I think there's anybody who wants to do that sort of work, I think would be just well advised to do so. What do you see as the future of human factors in Australia? What's the upcoming elements? You mentioned health, and a couple of others there, but is there any sectors in there that perhaps you weren't expecting to be coming up, or just generally you're fascinated by?
Look, to be honest, I think health is the future here in Australia for us in terms of human factors and where it will be developed. Remember, the big area I haven't mentioned here in Australia, of course, is mining. So there's huge work that's been done in mining here in Australia, and there's still people obviously working in mining, clearly, and That's quite a political discussion, I know, so we won't go there. But there's lots of great human factors work that's been done in mining, and a lot of our peers and people who, yeah, I admire for their work are working in that area and doing great work. And health is just interesting for us at this point in time, because before now we've had limited traction. And because AI is being used in health, and I'm not across AI generally in the work that I personally do, but I know that they're using it in certain aspects of health, it's a field where we may be able to address both things. So some of the great concerns here in Australia are clearly what AI is and what it's doing. And we have great professionals like, you know, Paul Salmon obviously talking about what that is and how it will impact, and the importance of having human factors professionals involved in artificial intelligence and artificial general intelligence. Please don't ask me to define the two. That might have me going, hang on a second, I need to find something and read it. But the bottom line is health is an area that is growing. Obviously, we've just not been to work in that space. So there's a lot of opportunities in there. Plus, I think we are seeing some more traction in small business. Australia has a lot of small business, and it runs in all sorts of different areas. There might be a service industry, and they've been a hard group to reach because they tend to do their own thing and stay out of regulatory areas. So they just don't read the material often. They don't know about the material. They probably don't even know they should be reading the material. And so I think we're slowly starting to see some more work there, which is exciting because that's a large part of our employment. The other area that sprang into my mind and then sprang straight back out of it again was psychosocial risk factors. Okay, so we've just had some new codes of practice on psychosocial risk factors that have been published. And so rather than it being the grey area, we're now addressing it head on. So the organised and the way people are treated at work and the work culture is extremely important, and that is now being looked at factors perspective, and so a workplace safety perspective. So that enables us then, and all our professionals who are psychologists, to be able to work in those spaces to improve our systems of work and improve the workplace for people. So they are some really big areas, and there's a lot of interest in that at the moment in Australia.
Cool. Sounds like there are bags of opportunities to be taken and explored. So that's really, really exciting. How do you see this evolving then? Because obviously we're talking at an international level. I guess that sounds very posh, doesn't it? We're having a natter this. What opportunities do you think there are for us to share and learn from each other?
Okay, well, we have slightly different industries, and we have industries that we do well that you might not have, that you might be developing, and the reverse is then true. So because you have, as I said, an incredible background in human factors in health, and I remember many years ago seeing Kevin Catchpole, obviously at a conference in Australia, was fascinated, desperately wanted to work in human factors in health, and actually was the reason why I went to a hospital job as it happens, to do some patient safety work to start with and then try and weave my way into human factors. But at that point in time, I couldn't break the door down. They didn't understand what I could do for them. And in fact, they probably just thought I was annoying. And so in the end I went, well, that's not going to work. I have to come in via another door. But gradually because we are starting now, obviously, where you guys have probably been for quite some time, there's that ability for us to collaborate on things and not make mistakes that you may have made at the beginning. So things that your professionals have learned through experience, we can then take on board and try and improve the way those things are done. I think lots of opportunity to be more global in our promotion of human factors and ergonomics. So for early career people, which are the society and the future of the world, in fact, in terms of of jobs, I think this is a great opportunity for us to be more global in talking about projects that we're working on or projects where we think human factors could work, and finding out what people are doing in. We actually here, and we have this skill shortage. We are bringing a lot of professionals in from overseas because we have roles that we can't fill here in Australia. So I'm hoping that there'll be some more opportunities there for us to obviously find professionals, but also opportunities to come and learn our skills that we may not be using here in Australia, or that you know, particular person may not be using. So I think the field is quite wide. I think the great thing is, it's for me, it's about promoting human factors and ergonomics and to the media as well. Road safety is a huge subject here. We haven't talked about that yet, and really thinking it's always good to talk and then you think about all the other things. I know road safety is a huge concern. Clearly we all have motor vehicle accidents all around the world. We have some extremely good research here in Australia, and we are wanting to have more input into road safety. And currently we have a little bit of input recently, last year and just recently, with a round table here in Australia talking about human factors. But what the professors who are emeritus professors, Anne Williamson and Professor Mike Reagan, both of them have indicated that really the road safety realm doesn't understand human factors clearly here in Australia. And so they only take on board the piece they want. They don't take on board the piece they don't understand. And so those doors get closed. And so what we are trying to do, or would like to do, is to possibly through our podcasts, but also through contacts and networking and saying more in the public arena, is have the government understand how important this is, and understand that decision making when people are driving, and driver distraction and driver is connected to so many of these motor vehicle accidents, be they high speed or low speed. And it's not just driver distraction. There are so many other, you know, factors in there. But all the things that happen in your car, you know, if you've bought a car recently, and I bought one recently, and seriously, it requires a manual to actually program the radio station. And because there's nothing spatial, about it, you can't just go for the knob, so to speak, and twiddle the knob that used to be on the dashboard. You now got this multi-screen thing that's happening. You've actually got to pull over, which is obviously what you should be doing, but you have no choice because you just can't actually get it to work. Maybe that's the theory, so you should pull over. But clearly people won't, and so they'll be distracted, and so the likelihood of accidents is so much greater. So there's just so much work that can be done in these spaces. And so I think as we collaborate with you, you'll have information about, yeah, what you're doing with driverless vehicles, which we're currently talking about, but we're obviously not doing in states. They're running driverless, fully autonomous vehicles, and we're not using them here in Australia really to any great extent. We're used on small projects, you know, taking people around small amusement parks or something, but yes, in a wider scale. So there's lots of opportunity to compare notes and talk, instead of building silos, is to be really open about, yeah, what we're doing and how we can learn from each other. That was a long answer, sorry about that.
No, that's a perfect answer, because you're right, there is road safety is something that's quite high on the agenda here in Wales, in the UK, where I'm at the moment. And as you say, we've got, again, lots of people who work in health, but again, we've got issues around how they're siloed and passing information across to each other, never mind sharing this stuff on an international basis. So there is clearly lots of areas that we can collaborate on, and I'm very keen to make sure that we keep on talking. So I think that sets up an agenda for that really nicely. We're going to take a quick break, and then we'll get into the final three questions.
Okay.
Just before Barry gets to the final three, my name's Nick Rome. Let me tell you about this. Technology in our world is evolving at a phenomenal pace, and keeping up with what that means in the human factors world can be challenging. That's where Human Factors Cast comes in. Human Factors Cast is a weekly podcast that highlights and breaks down stories that are chosen by you, the human factors community.
New York State is giving out hundreds of robots as companions for the elderly.
Buttons in cars are safer and quicker to use than touchscreen.
The prototype just achieved a major milestone that actually fits the description of a flying car.
The show provides perspective based on experiences from different domains and different industries. We even cover some of the hottest conferences in the field. On this episode, we're recapping EHF, Ergonomics and Human Factors Conference, Neuroergonomics Conference, Human Factors and Ergonomics Society, UXPA International. Join me, Nick Rome.
And me, Barry Kirby.
Every Friday morning when Human Factors Cast drops on YouTube and your favorite podcast directory. And remember,
it depends.
And now I'm going to send it back over to Barry for the final three.
That never gets old. Anyway, it's amazing what two blokes can do in an afternoon when they're bored and trying to learn how to do video editing. So what we have for everybody who comes along, we have the same final three questions. And so let's get into them. So if you, what is your go-to book or paper that you sort of, is your go-to, is something you use repeatedly? And now, if you don't do a technical one, it can be a fiction one, if that helps, but what's your go-to thing?
Okay, well, I'm not a huge fiction reader, mainly because I think I read all day and I just don't have time. I was part of a book club, by the way, and I used to read the book the night before and then go, my husband said to me, this is pointless, Sharon, the idea is to think about it for longer than just speed reading. We'll skip the Moby Dick or something like that. But I tend to go to, in my work, it depends on the project I'm working on, but because I work predominantly in manufacturing, and I think one big item is to people why you can only design something so far, and it's the organizational factors that change the risk. So you've got to limit the amount of time they spend on it, and you've got to limit the repetitions in the task by not asking them to do 25 per hour. Not that they do, but they might ask 10 or 12 is something that's quite common. So a lot of my work is about looking at arguing why it's important to take rest breaks and why it's important to not have these tasks really repetitive. And I tend to go to the work of Asa Kilbom and her ergonomics guidelines and problem solving books. So she addresses some fantastic things which I use repetitively, and I use that word tongue-in-cheek, is that she took all those good things like taking rest breaks and reducing work demands and reducing, you know, the need for high productivity and all those things. And yes, yeah, so that's kind of my go-to book because that's really the field where I work in the most.
Cool. If you could and pick an age that suits you best, what advice would you give to your younger self?
Oh, okay. When I read this question, I was thinking to a younger other person. okay, what would I've done? Because of my age, and I'm not going to tell you what that is, but because of my age, I was limited in my career choices. And remember, we are in Australia, okay? So there's some limits by nature of how Australia was. I'm a child of the 60s. If I had my time over again, a message to myself might have been to have been more widely read about where I might start my career, because my career could have looked different if I'd realised earlier on that I loved machinery. And my husband thinks I'm quite weird, because I do like machinery. But, yeah, I'm fascinated by machinery. And packaging machines, if there's a packaging machine, you know, I'll watch it for hours. But, yeah, I probably would say maybe a little bit more wider read, or look a little bit further than the obvious for choices when you start. That would be what I would have said to myself.
Cool. Now fast forward a bit to, fast forward quite a lot to retirement age and kicking back and not worrying about the world of human factors, just enjoying your own time. What would you like to be remembered for?
Being enthusiastic about everything.
Cool. I mean, you can't ask for a much better thing than that. Sharon, thank you ever so much for taking the time to share your experiences and your background and your visions for the future with our listeners today and our watchers now. We keep on having to forget to say that. If people want to get in touch with you and engage with you either about the conference or about HFSEA or about your background and wanting to get to know more about you, how would they get in touch with you?
Okay, so currently the easiest way to remember it, probably if you forget my name, is to head straight to the Human Factors and Ergonomics Society of Australia and search for the president, because my details are on there. Alternatively, if you hop on LinkedIn, you can find me very easily as well.
Perfect. So thank you. And thank you all for listening and all for watching. Do comment, share and like. That will help other people find what we're doing. And we shall see you all on the next episode. So
thank you.
Thank you for listening to 1202, the Human Factors Podcast. Please do get in touch with your thoughts, questions and comments. You can contact us on social media such as Twitter, LinkedIn and Facebook at 1202 Podcast. See you next time. And remember, it's more than just common sense.